to consider persons and events and situations only in the light of their effect upon myself is to live on the doorstep of hell. Thomas Merton.
I wonder where our mind goes in the space between words.
Did I tell you not to have a daydream during discipline? See, that's your problem now. You're never listening. You embarrass me every time we're in public. You are the subject of my stranger when we are in front of strangers, and I'm starting to think you covet my temperament. You like seeing me act out. You like seeing me strain. You like hearing me shout and call you out your name, because why would you act so demented? Like I'm raising some animal. They ain't got no senses. That's why I beat you senseless, because things never change. Just let me finish my sentence, and we'll get back to the game. Didn't I tell you not to run away from this plantation, boy? White man ruled this nation, boy. You're better off taking this whooping and going back to your station, boy. This whip here was made for bulls. I shipped it all the way from Italy, so I'm about to whip you like a bull. Please excuse the simile on my face. 32 lashes for the 32 teeth I used to pace. I only got 7 now, but looks won't win this race. You're lucky we let you live long enough to lift this cotton. You're a strong stock of slave, so we won't put you in a coffin, but you're gonna learn your place. I promise.
Tell you not to be a little pussy. You over here crying like some cookie. I raised you to be a man. If your mother was alive, she would be ashamed of your punk ass stance. You probably think you can take me, shrimp. What, you want this picture of your mother back? You think you can make me pimp? Ain't no man in here but me. And as long as you under this roof, you better knock out them chores before I knock out a tooth. You little faggot, you just a punk. You wear panties, tell the truth. And I bet you like guys too. All over your... Didn't I tell you not to tell anybody about us? Remember, it's a secret. You can get in a lot of trouble if you decide not to keep it. I believe we're like family, so don't worry too much. It's okay. Family that love each other always touch in this way. I am a gentleman, and your silence is required if I am to be gentle with. Do you remember the last time you shouted SOS sentences? I had to fall down the stairs? Every time someone asked you about your injuries, just stay in a child's place, but act as an adult would. I'm not trying to hurt you. Plus, doesn't this feel... Not you tell I didn't. I wonder where our mind goes in the space between words.
We need more trees. Not strong enough to hang from noose and throat, but strong enough to swing on seat and rope. But nature has not been kind to us. Post-traumatic slave syndrome, no shade, but do you expect us to keep our cool? Herd it like cattle, stockpiled into neighborhoods, concrete jungles. How do they expect us to grow, knowing nothing grows from the concrete? Without breaking ground first, how much stronger do we have to be? Carrying nations on our backs, eating scraps, falling from the tables of our oppressors, scientifically proven to be people of depression. Oh, the pressure is weighing down. Striking at our heels only makes us run faster, not farther. No wonder we've come up short of the finish line. Every day the gun sounds. No wonder we're off track. Running in this human race, it's hard to tell us to keep showing up when it seems we will never win. I mean, bring back the trees. Nature reflects itself. And I know you can breathe out prospect.
I guess it's time for the teacher to teach.
I guess so, man.
Look, pull out our notes. Hope our minds she can reach. Shoot. It's rough around these parts. Class is 12 students too many. Teachers stress from stretch paychecks. Supplies too few.
Talk about it.
I'm afraid to ask for a pencil. I mean, it's not like I could borrow one from any of you. Shoot. See, the board wants to teach us to the test. Mm-hmm. But the questions don't make sense. And if the books keep changing the facts, well, who's capable of retaining the knowledge within? Because I remember back when we was freshmen, they said Black history started with slavery. See, but now that we're seniors, they say we weren't even slaves no more. Mm-hmm. They say now we are working immigrants. Mm-hmm. And that Tubman was a thief and a terrorist. And if this is the dribble we supposed to stomach before the ACT and the SAT and whatever standardized test they come up with next, who's to make sense of it? Who? What good is a degree to me with a school that can't teach me properly? Hmm. You know what? You know what they say, right?
What?
They said, who's that one dude we was listening? Here we go. They said, the least of learning is done in the classroom. Mr. Merton was more right than he knew. I'm not sure that we'd learn anything if we left it up to you. And excuse me, I'm not talking about the teachers. They're just doing their jobs. But I'm talking about the ones in positions of power who won't take the time or have the gall to even the odds and shoot. If we was playing sports, that wouldn't even be an issue. Wow. You know what they say? They say, pick up this ball or swing this bat. No, no need for economics. Why do you even need to study that? They say, you know what they say? They say, jump this hurdle.
Man.
Sing this tune. No need for honest English. What good does that do? See, that type of rhetoric is the carrot that they dangle to us on our side of the tracks.
Talk to them.
And it's crazy.
They don't want to hear that.
They don't, bro.
They don't want to hear that.
That's what they dangle. And...
Dangle.
And I could go on. I could go on
don't
and
do
say
it. Don't do it to
it.
Him, Bloodbath. Don't do it to him, bro.
So, look, man, it's 30 of us in this class, right?
Man.
And with a fight in that corner and someone crying in this one, how can my teacher answer my questions about ancient thrones if more teachers are adding their kids to this war of hormones, attitude, and anger? And I fear that our education is in danger. And that's what this is, a war, a fight to the finish line in a system designed to diminish mine or in all cases to criminalize. But I bet you could tell me about that pipeline. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Hold on. You want us to set us down? Okay. All right. Okay. We'll be quiet. We'll be quiet, man. I can't wait for this bell, bruh. Tired of being in this class. You know, bruh. You know I got more to say.
Hey. Turn up on them.
Because what good is a school that pretends to teach me to succeed? And here's where it gets deep. See, I've been doing my research. Mm-hmm. You know, the taxes of the people in certain neighborhoods, I saw this on Google.
What?
They say the taxes of the people in certain neighborhoods determine the financial ability of the schools they're in. So that means if our parents, like yours and mine,
mm-hmm.
weren't afforded the same job opportunities as those across the way, well then what's there to be left for us, for the kids?
Right.
Where's the spark to light our darkened paths? I mean, our school can't even afford to feed us food for lunch, but their school can buy a stadium, bro,
A stadium.
No!
I'm sorry, bro.
It's all good. You good?
I'm good. I'm
okay.
Good. I get you.
Let me come back.
Go ahead.
A stadium, bruh! A stadium! We ain't even got a track team! You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Financial backing that to equate to proper staffing, and we're just left with what's left. Glorified babysitters teaching basic literature because a report came out that said that all schools weren't smart enough to handle Shakespeare. Mm. Which is funny. We We can't even get funding for the arts, but you know what they can do? You know what they can do? They can supply our entrances with security guards and metal detectors. They're policing our hallways like we're somewhere in a prison sector, teaching us like we're animals, like we're criminals, Brian. I remember I said that they were trying to criminalize. The system is designed to keep us behind our kind.
Talk about it.
We're not even learning the same lessons. Hear what I'm saying?
I hear you.
I bet you instead of business math, they get AP calculus. I bet you instead of just regular English, they get honors or AP. I bet you instead of being expelled for fights, they get in-school suspension. We're not even offered the same type of attention.
No, that's not for us.
And you know, even a blind man could see that what they teaching ain't helping. And you know I got more to say.
I know you do, bro.
You know I got.
I know you do, bro.
Well, there's
I
that
know,
bell. Bro. So I guess that's
Let's
all
get
for
up
today,
out of here, bro.
Even me, Lord. Even me. In this vast world of people, Lord, please remember us. Lord, send the rain. Vindicate us. We trusted a system because we were taught that we could and we should. Blindly rejecting our eyesight, ignoring our insight in water with scents and funny colors. But what else do you drink when this is all you got and your baby says, Mama, I'm thirsty. See, here in the sticks of Flint, no one cares about us because we were forgotten long ago. But don't be fooled. This ain't a water issue. This is simply a repeat of history, an atrocity committed against people that those in power deemed as expendable resources. Lord, send the rain. This is well and soul deep. This is an injustice predicated by greed at the expense of people that are trying to piece ends together just to make life meet, just to have a piece of a shattered American dream. You see, some people don't get to choose their lot in life. You sip spring water and our children are simply trying to survive. Our life now contained in bottles that sit in corners of bedrooms, bathrooms, and kitchens. Our pain and misery measured in ounces, liters, and gallons. Yet we do our best to make it. We held up our end of the bargain. We did not ask for this burden, yet we carry it now on our backs like canteens filled with poisonous elixir. Lord, send the rain. We aren't asking for much. We never did, and perhaps that was the problem. You never saw us as people, as humanity blanketed in flesh. They saw us as worthless, but we are people that know the strength of the collective. A drop in an ocean is just a ripple. A city coming together shouting for justice is a tsunami. We are no longer asking, we are demanding, Lord, send the rain. Give us water, pure and clean, life-sustaining and soul-refreshing. Give us justice. We are fed up with your conferences and conventions. We want nothing to do with your pretentious slogans and goals. We are tired of your public relations and image making. We have had about all that we can take of your self-satisfying rhetoric. When was the last time you came and sipped a glass of water with me? When was the last time you looked in the eyes of your child and saw disappointment because you were the parent and you were supposed to protect them and you failed? When was the last time that you wondered what damage your child will endure years later? And what do you hand me? A bottle of Evian that simply spells naive backwards. Keep your bottles. That ain't what we want. We want justice. Oceans of it. We want fairness, rivers of it. That's all we want. That's all we've ever wanted. And when it comes, when justice rolls down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream, only then will my soul be satisfied. Until that day and every day I thirst. Lord, send the rain. Even to me, Lord, even to me.
Storm clouds gather here. Colorless rib rage, translucent fist fire, muddled mouth curses are verses. He is a shadow my papa warns me about. Ears shut, heart open. He wants all of me to keep for good. I don't believe him. Soul and legs are full and open. They say when death rests on your face, no soul can change its course. That is all that is needed and matters. I must carve time out of my schedule to paint on my face now. Rearrange contours meant for permanence. Disheveled, crooked, dislocated. This place is not mine anymore. I am a building tower in a quiet city. Vision blur, eye socket closed, salt clumps and stains. This love tastes bitter. Everything will be okay, the girl with pink lipstick tells me through the mirror. She can't feel the burn in my skin, pine needles in my spine. She can't feel how the earth turns differently for me under my feet. Her world is not of my own. The rain is thundersome, cumbersome under a shutter sun that lifts from folds, cracks, blinds until the day is done. There is a bruise for each mood, a shade shame kind of pain to pull from. So I cure remedy out the dresser drawer, dag sting of whiskey from the low shelf diner, watch the moon crash silence black and blue. This is a love I can't nip away at no how, but we are getting there. One day, we will all get there.
The whole idea of compassion is based on a keen awareness of the interdependence of all these living beings, which are all part of one another and all involved in one another. Thomas Merton.
Good evening. My name is Stacy Bailey-Ndiaye, and I'm one of the co-directors of Roots and Wings. When I was at the Muhammad Ali Institute for Peace and Justice at the University of Louisville, we noticed the same thing that I'm sure most Louisvillians notice. It seemed that week after week, every week when you turn on the news, somebody was being murdered. And we also noticed the pattern that just kept happening, how people would be the next day or the next day after on the street full of tears, there'd be candles, and everyone would keep saying again and again, this has got to stop, never again. And then the next week, another person is shot, and the next, and the next, and the next. And so we started getting frustrated by this. And so we said, you know, if we're gonna change things, we've gotta come up with a different way of thinking about this, a different way of talking about this. And so we developed the six manifestations of violence just as a platform just to start a different conversation. And so the first manifestation of violence is domestic violence. And that's in our homes, where we live closest to us. It's the sexual violence, it's the abuse, it's the emotional abuse that we see all the time. It happens to our spouses, to our partners, to our children, to the elderly. And quite often, we're silent about it because there's a shame to what happens behind closed doors where we're supposed to be safest. And next is community violence, and that's what we see on the street. So it is the gun violence, it's the crime, it's the intimidation, it's the bullying, it's what happens out there, all right? It's what keeps us wanting to sometimes stay inside, or when we're in certain neighborhoods, it causes us to look over our shoulder, or it causes us to not even go into certain neighborhoods. It really keeps us in bondage. Then there's economic violence, and that's about our access to resources. And sometimes, in most cases, I would even say, there's generally enough to go around. But some people have way too much, and some people have nowhere near enough. And quite often, we don't get a say in how much we get. Environmental violence, that's the harm that we're doing to the planet. And so whether we're using too much of the collective resources that were just given to all of us and belong to all of us, or we're careless about it, or we destroy, we're doing harm to ourselves. And this harm that we're doing to Mother Earth over and over again, you know, she's starting to hit back, and we're feeling it. And then what about political violence? That's about the power. Who has it, who wants it, who wants to keep it, who wants to keep somebody else from having it. It's the conflict, it's the war. It's really about power and control. And then finally, there's hate violence. That's about how we treat each other based upon who we are. It's about an us, it's about a them, and generally, it's gone on for generation after generation after generation. And so what's interesting about this is that these all work together to form a system. And so if you start to think about any particular issue, take for instance the gun violence I was talking about. The conversation's usually about those people over there. They need to stop acting like animals. But when you sort of run it through this framework, from through this lens, you start to ask different questions about, you know, is there maybe an economic issue that might be going on? You know, is there maybe potentially something about the groups of people here? Who has access? Maybe there's some background that we need to know. You see that all of these are collectively they form a system. If you look at, say, a situation like a war, you can run down each of these: domestic, community, economic, environmental, political, and hate. Aren't they all represented in that? And so sometimes we take a look at this as a system and we say, you know what, this is too overwhelming, I'm not gonna do anything about it. But in reality, that's where our power lies. We can be working on the issues that matter to us, and it's part of chipping away at the whole structure. And the real sweet spot in it is that we can look out onto other people who are working on issues that might not be the most important thing to me, but we know that they're working on the same structure. And so when we look out, we reach out a hand because now I found an ally. You know what? Together we can do something about this. Let's get on it.
Hey, how's it going, everybody? You guys feeling all right? Yeah? You been enjoying the show so far? Very good. I see some of you not clapping. It's okay, it'll get better. So we're gonna have a little crowd participation moment, all right? This is not just a Roots and Wings telling you how to name it and how to change it. This is you all being interactive with that change, right? So we wanted to focus on a few things. We just heard Stacy talk about a lot of stuff, and numbers seem to get across better for people, so we wanted to give you all some of those numbers, right? 91 Americans are killed on average every day by guns. 91 every day in the United States. So if you would, please, I was wondering what that sounds like. We're gonna count to 91, if you would, please. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Each of these beats represents a life loss to gun violence.
10, 11, 12, 13.
How high will we count?
14, 15, 16.
Tonight we're going to count to 91.
17, 18, 19.
It's a mother,
20,
a father,
21,
a sister,
22,
a brother,
23,
a wife,
24,
a husband,
25,
a stranger,
26,
your neighbor,
27,
3 lives lost.
1, 32, 33,
34, 35,
5
lives lost.
6, 37, 38,
and keep counting.
39,
I see some of you stop.
40,
41, you want to stop counting,
42,
but you can't ignore the number.
44,
every time you ignore the number, there is a loss of life from your indifference.
49, 50, 51,
keep counting. 52, 53, 54. These aren't just deaths in my neighborhood.
56, 57.
Gun violence touches us all.
59, 60.
Murders.
61,
suicides.
62,
unintentional shootings. Police shootings.
64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69.
Not even close yet.
70, 71, 72.
Keep counting.
73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81.
Still not done.
82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90.
ID1 Live. You see, it just took us about a minute and a half. A minute and a half to count how many lives have been lost in this past 24 hours. Keep that in mind. So we're gonna get a little bit more interactive with you all. If you all would look under your seats, some of you have instruments, some of you do not. If you're wondering why you don't have an instrument, I want you to think of those instruments as tools and resources, right? Look, you look and have nothing, huh? Are you a little sick? A little sad? You wanna join in? You want your cool drum, right? This is an example, though. This is not just, not just the last, right? This is an example. We want you all to understand that some people have the tools and the resources to participate, and some of us don't. So if you do not have an instrument, make it work. Cheyenne?
I'd like to invite you to do a heartbeat rhythm with us. If you do not have an instrument, find a way to make a sound. It can be patting your lap, tapping your toes, snapping. It could be using your voice in some way. Any way that you can to join in with us. We need you all for this experience, and it's very important that you all are with us in this moment. So please join us.
So, I'm gonna put up
And I want that corresponding color to continue and raise it up a little bit. Blue dot. Got a blue dot. I want you to play very loudly if you have a blue dot in your car. You all represent the 1 in 9 women in the state of Kentucky who will be raped in their lifetime. Take a minute to appreciate how loud that noise is. Take it down. You've got this color. There you go. Make it loud. You all represent the 1 in 4 women in the state of Kentucky who will experience domestic violence. Appreciate the noise. Now for a minute, we want to think about health equity and life expectancy in our city. Did you know that the life expectancy is about 16 years removed, depending on where you live in the city? 16 years, you have more life, depending on where you live. So, you have this color. I want to hear you. In the neighborhoods of California, Parkland, Portland, Phoenix Hill, Smoketown, and Shelby Park, on average, the age is 68 to 70. South Louisville, Valley Station, Butchertown, Clifton, Crescent Hill, you made it to 78. If your color hasn't been called, you should still be leaving. Let me hear you. Pledger Ridge Park, Highview in Oklahoma, and Southeast Louisville, you made it to 70. Excuse me. Highland, Fern Creek, and Floyd's Fork. Made it to 81. Keep going if you haven't been called. I want to hear it. Wow. Well, they are the lucky few. J-Town, Northeast Jefferson, and St. Matthew. Made it to a right 85. Now what do we have? After the music has stopped, after all the people have died, we have that select few, that 1% of us that got to see a nice ripe age. Had no outside influences to stop, all because of the neighborhood you lived in. think about that. Thank you.
Once crowded, resources aplenty. The factors of greed too strong to keep the Fed from feeding, and now, circumstances, avoidable at first, cause the mass untimely exits of those you pretended to care about, and in the wake, no one is left to help care for you, but rejoice. Huzzah! Congrats. Take pride and look around you, for you are the lucky few.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Theo Edmonds, and I'm one of the co-directors of Roots and Wings. It's been an amazing couple of days so far, and I found yesterday's media and the public trust an especially powerful experience for me. Among other things, the session explored how religion, media, and the politics of our society often collude for the preservation of power. Earlier this year in Kentucky, Senate Bill 180 passed by a margin of 22 to 16. This bill created a license to discriminate, allowing individuals and businesses to deny services to LGBT people without being penalized under local anti-discrimination ordinances. The bill opened the doors for discrimination against a wide variety of people whose relationships might run afoul of certain religious beliefs, including single mothers and interracial and interfaith couples. Interestingly, though, Senate Bill 180 defined protected activities as actions by people commissioned, employed, hired, retained, or otherwise used by the public or the government to provide customized, artistic, expressive, creative, and ministerial or spiritual goods. So tonight, as we engage in sacred wisdom through performance, I want us to just think about that for a second. Artistic and creative expression are attempting to be codified by those in political power as levers of power. Art is about power. Occupy Wall Street, Tiananmen Square, Arab Spring, Black Lives Matter. 2020 marks the 40th anniversary of the first known AIDS-related death in New York City. He was a Brooklyn school teacher. Between 1980 and 2000, 500,000 Americans were killed from this disease. In 1980, I was in my preteen years and just beginning to become aware of my sexuality and myself. And I was also becoming very aware that I was different from others around me. I was outside of what was considered the norm. I grew up a little gay kid in an Appalachian country church. And I understood at least a couple of times a year that sermon would be coming. That sermon was the hellfire and brimstone one where the preacher would claim quite emphatically that homosexuals, faggots, queers, and by then I knew that was me, were abominations and doomed to hell. Well, it had been, I was probably about 12 years old, and it had been one of those Sundays with that sermon, and I remember sitting very quietly with my family that night, wondering how I was going to keep my secret. The NBC nightly news came on, and there it was, two words, gay cancer. That's what they first called it. No one had even heard the term HIV or AIDS yet. Something inside me died right on the spot. There I was, alone in a little mountain town, different from my family and friends, and now, and doomed to hell, and it was quite certain now, according to the television, the media, that I was going to die from my own special brand of cancer reserved just for me because I was born gay. I remember walking outside that evening, right around sunset, and I had a little treehouse down by the creek. I don't remember why, but I do remember pulling out a little pearl-handled pocket knife. And I remember sliding that little dull blade back and forth over my finger until there was just this little drop of blood that appeared. And I remember wiping away on this wet, muddy treehouse floor, had that green color on it that it gets from the outside here in Kentucky. And much of that moment has shaped my entire life. Today at 46, I wonder what I would go back and tell that 12-year-old boy if I could go back in time and gently whisper in his ear.
That he's beautiful and that there was nothing wrong with him. And he was going to become something bigger than anyone ever told him he would be. And that everything gentle about him was his strongest gift. And he needs to love that.
Follow your dreams. Don't be persuaded by what others say or do or act or what they want you to do or what way they want you to go. And don't be afraid of who you are. I shouldn't have hidden until I was in my early 20s. Mm-hmm. I should have always been out and always stated what I was and not been persuaded by others. I would do it that way now.
I tell him, just hang in there, you know, you're going to learn a lot, and when you think that you learned a lot, you're going to find out that next year, and that next month, and that next week, you're still learning a lot, and just keep on, just, you know, have perseverance, because really, that's all that you need, just keep on, and have faith. And it doesn't matter what your faith looks like, it's going to change, and you'll be in the right place at the right time.
Probably just go for it. And I think that's probably cliche to say, that, you know, you should have just done it. You know, everybody says, you know, it's not regret for something you did, it's what you didn't do. And there's a lot of things that, you know, you're confronted with every day. And it's a hard thing because you just pass it up. And, you know, we're all here for a very short amount of time. And it just really sucks. And that's why I go back to your first question and say, you know, that perfect happiness, if everybody would just realize that we're all human beings.
Traveling through this world. some gentle movement snuck up on me. And it reminded me of the road home, where the good stuff is. It's my kind of road. It's the old junkyard road. The sights I've seen of some unbelievable things are the things that rescue me some days in unbelievable ways. When you see bloodstains on the floor, you know that's a place where there was some pain. That place back there at the mountain end of that road home, where your mama used to soothe your breaking heart. She'd soothe that aching little heart of yours with a rocking chair, and Jesus, she'd sing, "Rock me, Jesus." I remember one night, she sang all night long.
I'm going there to see my mother. I'm going there no more to roam.
You see, under the sun's golden fingers, the road still stretches back there, where the atmosphere is a heavy blanket, one that hides a hazy and incomprehensible wreck of a civilization. The road leads home to a place where beer and cigarettes meander in thumbless hands. The hands in the road all meander through the sharp creases of a brand new little Sears and Roebuck catalog, and that good book claims the good stuff is only a phone call away. And so you find yourself one day looking around for your thumbs on the road, because you want to order some of that good stuff for yourself today. You see, everything has a right way and a wrong way there. And wrong looks something like those turns you took a very long, long time ago. Right? I've come to believe that's that little white pearl moon under the strong hand of a mustached, red-headed, good-looking Benjamin. Everything back there is a story. A story about pain and faith and love. Pain, that is more than a word, brother. And faith, that's more than a word, sister. Those are the makings of love, and love's the road home to that little mountain town where there sits a church, a truck stop, a juke joint, and a prison, all pent in and cooped up at about 6 miles of pavement. 6 miles of paved heaven and hell, surrounded by mountain walls, and there in that little place, listen to me close. You know you're alive when you're sad. In that place, you choose sin or you choose Jesus. Doesn't really make a lot of difference. Those folks just want to know which side you're on. So the important thing is you choose. I've been known to go back and forth on that road many times. And when I get back to the mountain inn, well, my family and mom and them, they always look at me real funny, but familiar. And when I bounce back to the city and all my friends here say to me, "Hey, Theo, what the hell you been doing back in that little hillbilly town?" Well, what I've been doing for years is bouncing from one end to the other of that road home, killing time that just some days won't seem to die, and I'm eat up with guilt. Because I don't feel guilty anymore for things in my life that I have resigned that I will never get around to. I somehow manage to get around, though, every now and then to the country end of the road home, and for a while I'll make my peace with being there. Just like those clouds, I hang out a while, whether it's a penance or an act of love. I've decided that it makes no never mind. Because just like those clouds, that Appalachia sky is the one that I remember as mine.
I know dark clouds will gather.
I started bouncing this road a long time ago, back when I smoked weed, dog. I was a kid listening to that outlaw music dreaming, but as you see when you're a kid, it's really only too exciting. There's the excitement of dreaming of being an outlaw or being a preacher. The only difference between the two being that one toasts the Bible and one toasts the gun, and after 46 years on this planet, my friends, I cannot figure out what those preachers mean with all those guns. See, life doesn't have a lot of presents to offer you there, so as a kid, you find yourself making up things to do. Mostly, you're making up those outlaw dream things because you figure every end of the road town needs a bad guy, but even those southern outlaws go Pentecostal every now and then. You're rounding on the undesk Sunday mornings to talk it all through with a good man, but before Sunday morning, they never write something. Got to pass him Saturday night. Saturday night at the end of the road and a Pentecostal country thing. And no Saturday night is when you decide who you are. It's not those Sunday mornings. It's Saturday night at the end of the road of 6 days of hard work. 6 days you've been waiting on a promise of heaven. 6 days working hard and waiting on a promise that never seems to come. So Saturday night, you just take what you can get. And you get on down to the very end of the road, and there sits this little concrete block bar, your own personal Jesus, in the form of a redneck oasis right down the side of the road. And that little spot of Saturday night heaven feels good. Because it's the place for you and the rest of those sinners going to get down for real, because like they say there, child, if you love Jesus and you are for real, then by God you shall be saved. And so you save it all. You save it all up for Saturday night at the end of the road at a Pentecostal country town. For the clash of the sacred and the secular will play these little chairs. And where you dance around the pool table till you move by the skin. And that's good. Feels like the flames of hell some days at the bottom of a bottle of beer. And those roadside spirits have been known to move people, to turn rebellious, radical, and extreme. Have mercy, Lord, when I am rebellious. Thank you, Jesus, for showing me what it means to be a true radical. And when I move by the spirit, I can be extreme. I'm a roadside rebel prophet. Preaching. Down here to the end of the road, I'm a southern country boy who rides some days on a hill just to parley and then turns down the road some days to find the gossamer wings of an angel. But the truth is, when those people there look at me, me is not what they see. What they see is a queer little country boy standing down here at the end of the road for God and gravity way down hard. And God is all around there at the end of the road. Some days he sure was hard for me to find. I figured maybe it was because I was not looking at the same hellfire God as the rest of them. I was looking for a golden rule God. Maybe I was just looking for the gold tooth of God's crooked up and pinned down smile. I was looking for the face of a God that knows my sin is not original. No matter how much I might fancy myself, I'm an original sinner. And that's why I keep going back there, just trying to figure out how to be a man of God, because you see, man being what he is, Lord, he's going to find out who he is. You know the street, Appalachia, got the moments that happen there still to this very day. Where those old philosophers, lunatics, purchase their porches and preach, and while they preach that 12-year-old boy, home tied to his mama's head, and the friend old and country church says, and the game they say, son, God hates you for what you are, God hates him! Abomination! How? No wonder you call the town of God. And so cast out by the one you love. You find yourself one day on the side of the road. Just then, some gentle movement sneaks up on you. And it whispers in your ear, it says, child, I give you two eyes so you can see truth for yourself. And I gave you that big old heart because
You are worthy of loving. And oh, so worthy to be loved in return. And I gave you those 2 feet, so when you are safe and the time is right, you can travel out of this place. And you keep on walking. And then one day you're going to look up and you're going to find yourself standing in front of a home of your very own creation. And what you do, reach out, open the door, and step on in. And in that moment, you will discover that good stuff has always been.
I'm going there to see my mother. I'm going there no more to roam. I will be going over Jordan. I'm only
our true destiny. We do not find the meaning of life ourselves alone. We find it with one another. Thomas Merton.
I'm a billboard. leave her ready to serve and they'll get nothing. I'm a witness that you did this and I'm brand new. So I'm ready to go. And I'm gonna tell the world what they need to know. I swear to myself, but you let me go. I tried getting high, but it left me low. You did what they could never do. You cleaned up my soul, yeah. Gave me life, I'm so brand new. And that's all that matters. I love you first, but you first love me. In my heart, I cursed you, yeah. But you set me free.
Reminds me of Ella singing Summertime. And her heartbeat reminds me of Miles and Coltrane when the living was easy. Her smile is like kaleidoscopes that drift in the prisms of sunlight and rainbows. Her kisses are like butterflies doing pirouettes on my cheek. And although I am not certain, something tells me her hugs is what heaven must feel like. She is three. She is my niece. And with her lips, H's were robbed from her tongue, so instead of Hannah, she awkwardly calls me Nana, and I love it. I love everything about her, and I even love the 212 times she asked me, why, Nana? Why do caterpillars slink? Why do birds fly? And why can't I catch clouds in mason jars? I smile, amazed at her wonder at discovering this world. I wish I could take all the innocent parts of her and seal them in a time capsule. Keep her heart locked behind a glass case that says only break when this world is a better place. Wrap her innocence in a cocoon, halt metamorphosis before life steps in impatiently knocking at the door. You see, right now she doesn't see color. She doesn't understand prejudice. She doesn't know what hate feels like. She hasn't tasted the bitter fruit of injustice. She doesn't go to bed hungry, and no one has told her what she can't accomplish because she is a girl. No one has told her that she is too fat, too loud, and just too much of everything. Life has not robbed her yet. I cry for what I know is coming down the pike. I look around this world and I weep. I look into her eyes and I know that we still have a long way to go. You see, we are not finished. How can we be finished when 1 billion children worldwide are living in poverty? How can we be finished when a gun that was used to murder a young black boy is auctioned off for over $100,000?
Amen.
How can we be finished when 20 children no older than the age of 7 are murdered in classrooms? How can we be finished when a 12-year-old boy is shot to death on a playground in less than 60 seconds? How can we be finished when more than 500 million people in the United States are homeless? How can we be finished when 44 million people don't have health care and we are still debating if this is the right thing to do? How can we be finished when it is still a crime to be driving while black and we have to start petitions to remind the world that her life matters? How can we be finished when 9 black people are murdered in the pews of a church? No, you see, we are not finished. When I look into the face of my niece, big pools of brown eyes staring back at me, I know that we owe her and ourselves the opportunity to make this world a better place. Even in all of the pain, I still have hope. Even in all of this chaos, I still believe that there is goodness in this world. That right now we have an opportunity to live in a better place. A world brimming and vibrant with the vitality of promise. What is the essence of life, Aristotle asked? To serve others and to do good, so I will not lose hope. As Martin said, if you lose hope somehow, you lose the vitality that keeps life moving. You lose the courage to be that quality that helps you go on in spite of it. So every day I remember his dream. This will be the day when we will bring into full realization the American dream, a dream still unfulfilled. A dream of equality and of opportunity, of privilege, of property widely distributed. A dream of land where men will not take necessities from the many to give luxuries to the few. A dream of a land where men will not argue that the color of a man's skin determines the content of his character. A dream of a nation where all our gifts and our resources are not held for ourselves alone, but as instruments of service for the rest of humanity. The dream of a country where every man will respect the dignity and the worth of human personality. You see, you can kill the dreamer, but you cannot kill a dream. It continues to live on in each of us. So we must vow every day to just do one thing to make this world a better place. And I try every single day in my corner of this world to leave fingerprints of my goodness all over this planet, because I am her Aunt Nana, and she's Cleana, a girl, a black girl in this world. And I refuse to let life rob her of the belief that she can still leap tall buildings in a single bound. Thank you.
Even though I can't see it, I know there's oxygen in air. Believe it or not, it's the same oxygen being shared by sinner and saint. It's the same element that made Southern Baptist mothers faint. It's the same relevance that made Michelangelo paint his ceiling. So if we all breathe the same belief of a God, why can't we inhale the same feelings? Even though I can't see it, I know God is in the air. From a mosque to a synagogue, from a church to a chapel, we wage wars in the name of names and pay our tithes to build a castle that was never needed for a king of kings. All he needed was water and air. Imagine us all kneeling down for a prayer. And we inhale to get in heaven, focusing our energy on everything that got us stressing instead of counting our blessings. Just like I forget to count each breath. I must be crazy to think that God is oxygen, right? What do you call God? Christ? Muhammad? Allah? Oshun? Iris? Hotel? Good God, we name our divinities more than we name our pets. You mean to tell me a man of God can ask for a jet flying on the wings of his followers' offerings with no feelings of regret? Yet I gotta feel some type of way for not gracing the church's steps. And even though I can't see it, I know there's air in a congregation that would extend an invitation to a pulpit of persecution. It's like the air that they offer is an optical illusion. Being uptight is strangling our evolution. Arguing over who's right is drowning religious recruitment. And I know there's God in each one of you, even though sometimes you just can't see it.
Thank you. it's no food for you. Can't buy no clothes since you've outgrew. You work too hard, no evidence. And
built your dream and crossed the cross.
Stacy, Theo, Edmonds, Lance, thank you all very much.